Hello, Columbia University. It's a pleasure.
Always knew you.
I'm R. Wayne, I'm the drug user.
No, what are you so pretentious?
I don't always do my taxes. I may need to do more drugs to do my taxes. But my children have never been hungry. Thank you for joining us Sunday at lunchtime. I've had a decent job for the past 4 years, so I know about Sunday brunch. We don't have mimosas, but as Carl Marx said, we will have some real shit. So let's get into the real stuff. This is a conversation about being whole. You know, we talk about how when someone gets out of prison, they need to come back into the community. How can we make that person whole again? This is a conversation about healing. So not only do we want that person to come back into the community to be whole, we want the community to also be whole and the community to heal. But more than anything, when it comes to this drug policy reform movement, this conversation is about how do we make this movement whole, right? How do we engage users and sellers in a way that we've yet to engage them? Not just have them come testify and tell a sob story, but have them at the table when the policy is actually being made, right? So that's what this conversation is about. Because if it's for us, but not by us, what does that leave us, right? And how do we define us? You know, we often want to advocate for the dependent drug user. What about the user who's not dependent? We often want to advocate, yes, go ahead and clap for that. Give us that. I'm trying to say, and how do we advocate for the drug seller, right? Not in some de facto type of way where the reform goes through and we keep it quiet that it may help the drug seller, right? But how do we just do it straight up in your face, advocate for the drug seller? Make sure we lower penalties for the drug seller. So that's what this conversation is about. Yes, ma'am.
I made a mistake. Let me own this. So this is what happens when I don't use a script, and I think I'm actually going to remember everything when I've been on 3 hours of sleep. There's one other person I really want to bring up to the stage, and I think because I was thinking about him as the person who would administer naloxone if you needed, I forgot, but Terrell Jones, a brilliant hard-working educator.
Can we give Asha a round of applause? Yeah. You learned a lot from the past 2 weeks. I've been feeling all the way from Colorado how hard she's been working. DPA, we have a signature issue. We want to remove criminal penalties for users and possessors. But how do you do that if you don't involve the seller? The user is the seller half the time, more than half the time, right? The seller is the user. With that, I'm going to ask these gentlemen to share the microphone. Terrell, we'll begin with you. And just simply tell your story. Tell how the drug trade may have been a part of your life, how maybe drug use was a part of your life, and how the drug war in general has impacted your life.
Good afternoon, everybody. Terrell Jones. I work at New York Commonwealth Educators. The largest serving exchange program on the East Coast. So, through my life, I shouldn't even be here, as I said at the DPA conference. Through my life, drug use has played a major part. From me being deemed a menace to society because of my drug use, my drug selling, me carrying guns, me being a violent person at that time, I'm not supposed to be there. When I got arrested, I was offered 9.5 to 18 years for selling crack cocaine. But evidently they brought that down to 4.5 to 9. But I was selling crack to support my habit. So when I asked for a drug program, I was refused. But the white counterpart of mine that was selling drugs was off of the program. I went up to Franklin Correctional Facility 5 miles away from the Canadian border. I had no contact with my family, had no contact with my kids. Sitting up there in this facility, only thing they had me doing was going out into the community up there, painting, fixing up their little towns. Nothing was addressed about my drug issue at all. In those valuable years, no contact with my kids. Family wouldn't come up there because it was too far. You know, I thank God for harm reduction. I really do. And one of the things that really hurt me about it is that black people are not involved in harm reduction. Because we look at it as an intervention for individuals who are IDU, intravenous drug users, which is not. I'm a crack user, and harm reduction helped me get my life together. One of the things that you know that's really important to me is that, yes, we must address this issue on heroin. Well, let's address this issue on crack too, because it's still devastating our community. You need to look at the fact that how many people on a daily basis are still being arrested for crack use, which is not being addressed. And those individuals that lives are being destroyed because of they have no contact or nothing with their families either. Yes, we need to have more prevention around crack use with harm reduction. The fact that today is still going unnoticed and we're putting more emphasis on the heroin use, but let's talk about how many people are dying from overdose of crack use. Something that we're not addressing. Thing, you know, like I'm saying, I've been doing this work for 13 years, and to see the devastation that drug use has caused in my community, the separation of families, black men that don't have ties with their kids and their families, because the first thing when we get arrested is we're sending up north to jail. We're not given programs. We're not given an affordable opportunity as other individuals are being given. The first thing they look at is, well, let's throw them in jail. Maybe they'll learn something. Which create a cycle of the black man not being home with his kids and his child. And this is still going on today. Like I said, I'm an outreach worker too. And I go into my community every day and I talk to people. I look at what's going on out there in the streets. The stigma between people that use drugs. We need to start changing the language. And that starts with us. But I have no faith in politicians at all. Even though on some days I go down and talk to city council, I go to Albany, I go to Washington, and I advocate for our people. But do they really care about us? See, it's up to us to put a fire under their asses. Because, like I said, when I spoke to a lot of individuals back, Latino, Asian caucus, they really didn't know and understand about harm reduction. One of the things that was brought out in that is that harm reduction brings no money to them. And that's a shame because we're talking about saving people's lives. So is the money more important or the lives of the people in our community important? And that's for us to do. We need to understand that we are the one that's going to take back our power. We're not going to just sit there and leave it into the hands of the politicians because we see what they're doing. This fair war on drugs has been going on for how long? 40 years? Nothing has changed? When do we, as people in this community, start taking back our power? When do we say enough is enough? I've been doing this work, I said, for like 13 years. And the fact is that our politicians have not done nothing. All they have done is reap off the benefits of our people, of our community.
Appreciate it, sir. All right. Shadow, quickly, your story as well.
So I'm going to skip a lot of my story, and because I think for me the ending is really important. And so I'm the executive director of the People's Harm Reduction Alliance, which is the largest user-run needle exchange. I am a co-founder of the Urban Survivors Union, a national drug user union. But the two factors that made all of that possible and that changed how I was going to be treated and how everything was that I was born male and I was born white. And so I am replacing at the exchange that I've been for 20 years, I replaced two other white men, right? And unless I do and we do something to change that, a white man will replace me. And I have engaged the drug use. Drugs have saved my life. They have been a major positive force in my life. They have given me opportunities engaging my brain in a way that I could never have possibilities to do. They have made it so I have to work with people and engage people that I never would have met before. So all of that is possible. But the simple fact that we don't really talk about, and I know we're talking about race here, but it's that people like me get to end up as executive directors, right? It's that's how this system works, right? And look at the harm reduction world and look at positions of powers. You start going into rooms with executive directors, it is all white men. There's some female, white women there.
Or female.
Or female. But it's like, how did I get here as a street drug user? Because the best and the brightest, they died or went to prison. And I was the trash that was left. And I was the one, I was the only thing left to take over. So I am not an incredibly talented human being. I am just literally the drug user who was left when everyone else has died, everyone else is in prison, and I was all that was left because I did not want to be the person who spoke up and screamed and yelled and got their life trashed because they were gonna say, I'm drug user and I'm proud. But I was all that was left in my community. So it was time for me to stand up, and I just took the plunge and I did it, and I never stopped fighting, you know? But it's not going to change unless we acknowledge why I'm at this table, right?
Appreciate it, Shadow. Dorothy. Dorothy, I have a specific question for you. Because I know asking you to just tell your story could go a while. So I'm going to ask you a specific question later, but I want the elder Mr. Hayden to first speak and tell us about his experience with Nikki Barnes, what it meant during that time, how it may have elevated his situation in life to be a part of that Nikki Barnes outfit, and you know, what brought him into the drug trade and his experiences with the drug war as well.
First of all, let me say, I don't like being typecast. I don't like being looked at as a formerly incarcerated person. I don't like being looked at as a former drug dealer. I am bigger than that.
That's right, baby.
Those periods were just a chapter in my book, in the book of life, right? Drugs, I haven't used them in 45 years. 45 years. Just like I made a decision to start using them when I was 16 years old, I made a decision to stop using them, you know, 45 years ago. And as simple as that. I didn't need no drug program. I didn't need anything. All I needed was the decision to make that decision to stop, and I stopped. In my life, I've done many things. I've traveled around the world. I've lived at the top of the pyramid, and I lived at the base of the pyramid. You know, I've had a full life. I'm 74 years old now, and I'm sitting here talking to you. 2 weeks ago, I was arrested and abused by NYPD simply because I was filming an incident. So, and when I was dealing drugs, At the same time I was dealing drugs, I was trying to get a garbage can on every corner in Harlem. Yeah. So my life with drugs didn't, you know, there was an alternate side of me that also existed. And that side came out of me when I went to prison. When I went to prison at 16 years old, I woke up. I was arrested for a small amount of drugs. And that was my first stop and frisk. That was in 1957. My mother got me into a program, or got a program to accept me. And when I went to court, the judge said, no, you're not going in a program. You're going to prison. And he sent me to prison. And I went into prison with 20/20 vision. In 6 months, I woke up and I was blind. I was sitting in the mess hall and I went blind, literally. But it was temporary blindness. And that blindness came from reading books through the bars. I woke up at 16 years old and I haven't stopped since. I haven't stopped since. I got kicked out of every school I ever went to, and I ended up with 4 college degrees, 2 associates, a bachelor's, and a master's degree. And was even accepted into Harvard on a scholarship, Harvard Divinity School, to study community organizing. I've been a community organizer all my life. You know, even when I did the, what society calls the bad things.
Did you feel like a bad person when you were involved in the drug trade?
I didn't feel like a bad thing. No, I didn't. And I'm gonna tell you the reason why. Because all of the people that I was dealing drugs with and dealing drugs to were consenting adults. They were not children. They were consenting adults. We had something they wanted, and they had something we wanted. And it was simple as that. The pharmaceutical companies in this country, the pharmaceutical industry in this country, they got me hooked on high blood pressure pills for life. Huh? They got me hooked on high blood pressure pills for life. I can't quit, because if I quit, I'll die. You know, there's absolutely no difference between Big Pharma and what we were doing out there on the streets of Harlem and across this country. Absolutely no difference, man. I've become an expert on the law and the history of drug prohibition. And it was racist from the beginning to the end. It started with the Chinese.
That's right.
You know? And it went to the Mexicans and blacks and Hispanics. You understand? And it was all to give Big Pharma a monopoly on the drug market in America. And that's all it was.
Would you say we have maybe a problematic drug dealer and a non-problematic drug dealer? I mean, how would y'all deal with the drug dealer who was preying on youth, if that person even existed? Or I don't know if that person is a myth or what. But, you know, we talk about problematic drug users and non-problematic drug users. Would you say there's the same thing when it comes to drug sellers?
Well, how do doctors deal with it? Huh? How do doctors deal with problematic drug users?
Give them no drugs.
Huh? They don't give them no drugs. Right? I mean, they out there to make money. Listen, this whole narrative about drugs has to be changed. It has to be changed. We have to seize control of this narrative, man. Because this whole narrative, man, Ehrlichman, Nixon's vice president, I think.
No, oh.
Advisor.
Huh?
Advisor.
You know, just confess, you know, that the whole war on drugs was a way for them to control the anti-war population and the black population.
That's right.
Let me move to Dorsey.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay.
So the term structural inequity, structural racism has come up. The need for economic justice, healthcare justice when it comes to black and brown folks. You know, given that we are, 50 years from the Civil Rights Movement, 150 from the Emancipation Proclamation, 400 years in when it comes to slavery and so forth, we still got work to do, basically. And given this reality, given the fact that we need economic justice in our communities, why do we look so down on the drug dealer who's just trying to put some money in his pocket, or just trying to pay the light bill, or just trying to buy a Similac because for some reason the mother of his kids is breastfeeding? But don't let me go on a tangent, but why are we still so hard on the drug dealer given everything we face in the society and given structural inequity and structural racism?
Take it home, baby. Take it home.
Sarah.
Take it home.
I'm the one that showed up at your conference with 20 other people saying, wearing the t-shirt saying, let's not screw Pookie again. Because y'all getting ready to come to the end of marijuana prohibition. And y'all gonna screw them the same way you screwed them when we came to alcohol prohibition. You're gonna screw them the same way you screwed them when we came to the end of number running and took it into lotto. I think that I got into the business, and I wish I could say that I was a success. I actually think that when I got to prison and I seen it was predominantly black and brown people, that notion was dispelled almost immediately. And I'm the person that you don't call for, because I'm a person that was convicted of first degree murder at the age of 19. And every time you talk about your reform, you exclude me right off the top, as if we had the same access to financing our habits, our needs, or our desires. It may not mean that way. I'm also the founder of a treatment center, and the basis in which I found the treatment center wasn't necessarily to get people in recovery from drugs, but to get people engaged in a fight for their freedom. We named our place Free at Last. That had a basis in which we named our thing. And I need to say that when we open it, we open it and we recognize that we was victims, and we started doing needle exchange. And I'm a 12 stepper, but I believe that's not how many steps you need to get to the top of the mountain. You know, so we did needle exchange. We introduced methadone maintenance inside of our program, because we didn't figure like a person can hear you if they throwing up on your shoes. So we started doing different stuff. A number of things that was mentioned, I think I need to say I'm a formerly incarcerated person, because within that space and that identity, I fight for the full restoration of my civil and human rights. And most of the time when people talk about recovery, they think I'm talking about recovery from drugs. I'm talking about recovery from slavery, because that's where I stem from. You know, so it ain't that shit, you know, that I'm cracking down on drug dealers, because like when I didn't have an opportunity and couldn't feed myself, somebody passed me the sack. And I didn't necessarily think that it was a real reasonable choice, but a last option. Because I couldn't feed me or my family. So I ain't never objected or hated people that gave me an opportunity to feed me and my family. So every year I throw a picnic, and I'm a part of a picnic called the OG Picnic, right? 4,000 of us show up, right? So when y'all talk about Proposition 47 and y'all talk about fingerprinting people so they can get their records clean, if you think our ass is gonna come back down to the police station for that privilege, you crazy as fuck. And by the way, when we talked about ban the box, because I'm one of these
Go ahead.
I'm one of these people that went from the gates of San Quentin through the gates of the White House. And when I got there, and I was there for the business of ban the box, it wasn't the first thing that I said. The first thing that I said was that my son may not be going to get Skittles and iced tea. He could be going to get a beer and a blunt, and I still expect his ass to make it home safely. So I got a different feeling about this shit, right? Because I ain't used in 25 years, right? The only reason that I didn't is because I made a promise to some black men inside of a correctional institution. That I wouldn't fucking forget, you know? So I need to say that. Some people just want to get high. I don't just want to get high. I want to win a fucking revolution so the next time I hit a joint with you, we'll be there and actually had a victory we can celebrate.
Go ahead, Tyler. Tyler, if you prepare to speak, we're going to go ahead and open this up because there's not much more than I can do up here. Ms. Green, Kelly Green, I believe we want you to come up and share some reflections, as well as our very own Stephanie Jones. Please, ladies, make your way up to the front. Go ahead, Sean.
So, I think it's really important that everyone be aware. I am an active injection drug user and use drugs every week. I am also the only Caucasian person on this stage, and I'm also the only person who's never been in prison. So I think it's very, very clear that we have to understand how this plays out. And the white folks in this audience need to understand that they are here and are because of their privilege. And I got out of so many cases and so many incidents simply because I was male and the color of my skin, and watched close friends of mine go away. And I'm thinking, when I'm young, I got out. Wow, that's slick. I skidded the system. I didn't. The number one factor that changed my life again was I was born white and I was born male.
Okay. I think I know a little bit about that light skin privilege too. You just don't have to be white to enjoy that privilege in this society.
I wish.
Calm down, baby.
I see myself treated better, gotten certain jobs that I think some other brothers could have got treated better by police on occasion. So, you know what? We all family here. I'm going to talk about any of that.
We got to own that male privilege, too. We got to own that male privilege, too, boy.
Oh, yeah. Okay. See, that's what
I'm going to do. But no. Own it. Own the shit. All of it.
I get a pass on being a part of the impacted community, but I don't know what it's like to have to deal drugs to feed my kids. I never was to the situation where, you know, it was do or die, or it was a survival economy for me. It was a choice for me, and right, I never got caught, because I wasn't that good at it. I wasn't making that much money anyway, right? And I never got caught, so I don't know what it's like to go through the system. So, you know, sometimes I could wear an impacted community badge, but I don't believe I should have thrown that badge on many times. I think we need y'all at the policy table. So I appreciate you talking about all the different policies that you all helped get started, Dorsey. I think your trailblazer in that way. And I'm hoping to do some of the stuff you did in California and Colorado. One more round of applause for Dorsey and all the work that you've done.
Hi, I'm Stephanie Jones. I work for the Drug Policy Alliance. I run a program called Music Fan, and I'm going to take it a little bit further away from what we just talked about, because that program, it talks about harm reduction and drug education in nightlife and festival settings. So when we talk about people who use drugs and people who sell drugs, there's a incredible diversity of experience that we need to bring to the table. And a little bit of back and forth here kind of demonstrates that. We have people, as Dr. Carl Hart mentioned in the last session, most of us who use drugs are not using them in problematic ways. They're not using them in dependent ways. And that's from all communities, white communities, black communities, Hispanic and Latino and Asian communities. And what I wanted to bring to the table is the importance of getting accurate information into all of those different communities. No matter where you're sitting or standing, where you're at in the world, every community deserves that knowledge. And like, that just goes from drug education, straight up drug information, accurate, and all the way into how the drug war is impacting your particular community. So I'm really happy to work very closely here in New York with my friend here, Kelly Green. She runs New York's DanceSafe chapter, and so I'm gonna let her say a few words.
Hey everyone. I had zero prompts about speaking up here today in this room, so bear with me while I try to collect myself. But yes, my name is Kelly Green. I run the New York chapter for DanceSafe. And we are a harm reduction organization that sets up harm reduction booths at EDM-based events around the country and Canada. Here in New York City, I am about 10 years deep in the rave scene as a harm reductionist and as a raver. I see in the community probably more minorities than we see white people. And the face of EDM tends to be that everyone assumes that it's a bunch of white people hanging out, doing drugs at a party, and, you know, listening to the Beachy or whatever. But in reality, you know, in the underground where there's a lot of parties, probably every other day, every weekend, I see a lot of minority groups, because that's a lot of where electronics came from, Chicago, Detroit, so techno houses in those mornings. So, you know, as an arm that, you know, in the scene, I've seen a lot of things, and I wanted to reach back, help my own community, help my own people, and people that are affiliated with us. So I started up the New York Dance Day chapter about 3 years ago, and I'm every day trying to find ways to get it out that it is everybody's problem and just as much of a minority problem as people think it is a white people problem. It's not a white people problem. It's everybody's problem. It's just that it doesn't really blow up in the media in the same way until it's pretty white girl who dies at a festival, unfortunately. So we have the same problem in our community. I actually have a close friend who was in the rave scene who actually attended this college, living in 21, when she died from recreational drug use. And not because she was an addict, but because she got a hold of her own stuff. Mm. So, here I am.
Thank you, Pat.
Thank you, Kelly, and Stephanie, for those good questions. And we want to use that to begin to open up for some questions. And so because we have, I say one, you say Mike, up here, I'm going to ask you to form a line so we can get some questions for our panelists and for the folks who respond, Stephanie and Kelly as well. So if you have some questions, please come and form a line over here.
Hey, Asha, yeah. I just got one question because Dr. Hart, you did make me think about something. How come when white folks get addicted on hop, They have an epidemic, and we have a crime wave. So, like, I'd like to know, how do race play into this shit on a real level? Because the way that they pursue me and mine could be totally different the way they pursue other people. So, like, I want to know, what is an epidemic, and how come my shit is a crime?
So as we think about the opioid epidemic, I think that's what you're talking about.
Yeah.
It's important for us to be careful. Like the New York Times ran a piece saying that something about now that it's white people with opioids and heroin, it's now a gentler war on drugs. Washington Post ran a similar piece now that the face of the drug reuser is white with being more gentle. We have to be careful because all of those kind of conversations coming from the New York Times, NPR, Washington Post, it's a setup. That's playing into, it's not really talking about race. If you want to talk about race and the opioid situation, what you need to do is go through any of your local newspapers. On the one hand, we're saying let's be compassionate with these users because they're white. And we all should be saying that, no matter who the users are. That's a good thing.
Yeah.
But the thing that we are failing to talk about is who is being arrested for opioids now in terms of trafficking. That none of these conversations deal with that. And that's where the real issues are. And so please be careful about falling into that simple narrative that these writers, these progressive liberal writers are writing about. It's a distraction. Stay focused on who's going to jail. Because black people are going to jail for opiates today. And not we don't need to go back to crack. Because we were compassionate for certain types of crack users. People don't think so, but if you go back and you read your newspapers, it was the same narrative. And we should have been compassionate. But we were not compassionate for black people who we said were trafficking. Just like we're not compassionate for them in a wide range of areas, a wide range of domains. So this ain't unique. So keep the focus on
who goes to jail. All right.
And we think the centralized response that two doors and then we're going to open up to questions.
Just to say that there are some solutions, like between recreational areas and this opioid crisis, if that's what we want to call it. Like one of the things that Kelly does, that DanSafe does, is drug checking. Like in this community, having adulterants in drugs has always long been an issue. And that's a solution that can be outside of this community. So I would like to like start building bridges. We need to have the full depth of the conversation. Who's getting arrested? Who's using the drugs? Where can we get solutions from other communities? And so I thank you for bringing that up. And there's a lot that we can all learn from each other.
Thank you so much, Stephanie.
I would have liked to see a woman on the panel. So
yes!
Let me address
that. To ask women often to sit on this panel, black women, to sit on this panel and say that they are active drug users risks them losing their children. And that is why we didn't put, there's a different risk that even women have. And so if you thought about it,
privilege.
And I want you to trust that we make very conscious decisions. And so that is why we also have responders, and we're having an open conversation. But there was no woman that we said, oh, we just want to have all men. That was not what we did. We had to determine risk, because it is still illegal for people to use drugs.
Right.
And it's still illegal for people to sell drugs. We also don't have any active drug sellers on this panel. So I just want to make that clear.
I want to thank you for that, because one of the things that we really need to realize is that when it do come to women, that how their issues are not addressed. About the feelings, what a woman has to do if she sat up on this panel, and the feelings that would be created in her, what she went through. Women issues are very sensitive and different from men issues. And we always got to keep in mind of that there, you know what I'm saying? And I appreciate that, because we need to protect that woman out there. Do you know how hard it is for a woman to come into treatment and the bars what she goes through?
Yeah.
That's some of the things that we need to remember, man. You know, like black women, white women are the pride of us, you know what I'm saying? So we need to keep that in mind, that their issues are really deeper than ours. It's hard to keep females in the treatment.
And we're really grateful for a whole day program in which we will also hear about solutions for peace in this drug war and the cost of the drug war from an extraordinary panel of women who will drop the mighty estrogen on the mic.
So,
what kind of estrogen? The mighty?
So, I want to add one more thing, and that is, okay.
Good afternoon. So, my husband is current is a former Coke dealer who's now incarcerated in Woodbourne. He's getting out in 2018, hopefully. But one of the things that I get from him is something I heard implicit in your comments, which is a little bit of shame and resistance around that label of I'm a formerly incarcerated person, I'm a prisoner. And I feel that, and I'm wondering how you feel that we can address that stigma to get folks like that involved, folks like my husband, who I think have brilliant perspective, but want to distance themselves from the prison label. Yeah. And then beyond that, Obama made comments this year about, you know, America is exhausted with white guilt. We're not interested in sympathy for people like my husband, people like yourself, who sold drugs for whatever reason. And so then how are we investing other folks in that sort of, in understanding this landscape of racism as it exists now?
Can I drift?
Yeah.
The reason that I wear that label is because somebody got to stay at home for that fight. Right? Because at a certain point, when you get down to, you know, what is the position of us who have a conviction history coming home when our loved ones stay in public housing, somebody got to step up and says, we want access to our families. We want to actually change public policy in relationship to housing. When it comes to the question of employment, if we don't step up and say that we want that box banned on employment, not just for the federal government, but for private contractors, because I'm paying fucking taxes too, right? And if I'm paying taxes and 25% of the labor market is being controlled by private contractors doing business with the federal government, if we wanted to end unemployment questions for me, somebody got to stand up and says that this is my fight. This is where I stand. This is where I resolve. Because, like, I'm not expecting y'all to save me. Mm-hmm. I expect that I will be saving myself with the fight that I initiate about my rights. When it comes to the question of voting, we expanded. Here's the four things we did in 18 months. One thing that we did in 18 months was we expanded access to public housing in terms of the guidance they probably issued in the last 2 weeks. We actually got the President of the United States saying that he's going to stop that crooked-ass shit on the federal application. What we got them to do is when they put in our requests for proposals on the federal government to change the language because they was calling us offenders in their language, mm-hmm. or when they doing a conviction history check, what they would call it is a criminal background check, which means that you would taint the information that you're looking for. The other thing that we did is in multiple places, we started expanding the ability to get access to the right to vote. We did that by something like 60,000 in the state of California when we expanded for the right to vote under post-release supervision. So we having a low intensity fight, and I feel the same way about it as Dr. Hart felt about it. If you're a formerly incarcerated person in this room, bring your ass out the closet and get in the street and fight with the rest of us.
The session was supposed to end at 1 o'clock, but we started 15 minutes later. Do you want to go 15 minutes into the lunch, or do you want 7 minutes? And we can put 15 minutes? Can you guys show your hands? We'll go another 15 minutes? Okay, and then we'll take. So sorry for you guys. Okay.
Yeah, the second half of the statement, I had comments that I prefer, but thank you for the clarification. My name is Elijah Marie. I'm the NGO representative for ICOM. And to the panel, the question is, the United Nations has declared 2015 to 2024 the decade of African people. What is it that you want us to do to make that platform relevant to the struggle for freedom?
Great question.
Does somebody want to grab that? Yeah. I've been coming to Drug Policy Alliance events for years, for decades. And I've been in the street. I've been an activist, community organizer. I'm the director of the campaign to end the new Jim Crow in New York. Me and Michelle Alexander are extremely close. And I just think it's time for the conversation to shift from problem to solution. I think we talked about the problem in the minutiae of the problem ad infinitum. And I think that it is time for us to begin to start talking about how do we solve this problem? Mm-hmm. We can't go on like this, because people are filling up prisons, jails, mm-hmm. getting killed by the police. And I mean, and all we doing is marching through the streets talking about no justice, no peace. Hands up, don't shoot. Power to the people, right? But we're not organizing on the grassroots level.
Thank you very much.
And until we begin to do that and start organizing in every poor community of color, this is where all these things are happening.
That's right.
We will be just like the people in Ferguson, Missouri. Mm-hmm. They didn't have a drug problem. They had a political problem. 67% of the population of Ferguson, Missouri were African Americans. They didn't organize. They didn't take advantage of the political process. They controlled it. I mean, they could have controlled it and controlled who was their mayor, who was their police commissioner, and how policy and practice would have been initiated in that community. So I'm saying that, we can sit up here all day and talk about the intricacies of this oppression that we are suffering. And we can talk about politicians in the bad mode. But if government is the organized power of the ruling class, the only solution is for us to become the ruling class in government, right?
Thank you, John. Thank you so much. And also to address that question, also to add on to that, I've asked my sister, Jean-Pierre Williams-Pomery, whose work as a special consultant with the UN, and especially working through here in Panama, but not only Panama, to talk a little bit about the process and how we might address that as organizers who are working to end the drug war and addressing it through a racial justice lens.
Hi, thank you very much. So the first thing with the UN is to know that the UN is not going to resolve anything. The UN is a vehicle to get our voices heard and to go over government on US soil. That's what the UN is. The important process of the United Nations is now in the decade, which I have my observations and reservations about. But in the process of the UN, the important thing is being able to get the issues out. So there's an undeniable fact that there are human rights violations that are happening, depending on the issues that we're looking at, and that is through civil society submitting shadow reports. The shadow reports then go in, they're heard, and they're read by a committee, an international committee, that then holds the United States, in this case, accountable to human rights violations, because they have signed international legally, they're documents that are supposed to be legally upheld by the governments. Yeah. and they're not being legally upheld. But in part of that, they're not being legally upheld because most of us do not know what they're legally supposed to be upholding, right? So part of it is educating ourselves through these kind of discussions around what are the international obligations, responsibilities, and legal obligations that the United States has to people, and then finding a way to uphold them through those international processes.
Thank you so much, Nubia. Thank you. So, let's see how many questions we have here.
Thank you very much. I wanted to echo something that was mentioned by a couple of your panelists about how the dispossession of people of color is cyclical throughout the drug war, and that it will happen even after decriminalization, even after legalization.
Yeah.
Until recently, I lived in Seattle, and that's something we're actually seeing there, where we have legalized marijuana. We have big stores you can go into, and people behind the counter have to help you. And those places have become anchors for budding gentrification in the city. And there's an artisanal donut store next door, and an artisanal
simplification. And I didn't mean to make that rhyme, but it, gentrification in the city of Denver has been going on for the last 30 years. Legalization is something that people can easily point to and say is the cause, but I think it's much deeper than that, and I'm pretty sure the same situation is in Seattle. But what is true is that the marijuana industry, 5-10 years from now, cannot look like the tech industry. Cannot look like all kind of other industries that are not inclusive. And what has to happen is we have to be there in the beginning where the policy is being written to make sure that the industry can be as inclusive as possible. And that stuff has to be written into the regulations. Colorado and Washington went first. We learned a lot of lessons from Colorado and Washington. Is this thing even on, or y'all just hearing it?
We hearing you.
And I think it's on us as reformers to make sure the industry is most inclusive, to realize that you're taking supplemental income away from our impacted community, to realize that you may create a system where we are not being involved. And it's on us as reformers to work with the industry to make that happen. I think what you see in California 2016 is setting the bar for what marijuana legalization should look like. And we're gonna learn from the mistakes of Colorado and Washington, but let's not put gentrification on legalization because it's not that simple.
Let me stack the next round. Charles, what is it about your city?
Yeah, it's not so much about my city, but I feel like something we miss is whatever group we're talking about and whatever group we're lobbying for or fighting for, we never really communicate in most part with that group. Right? We passed these laws and we're like, victory, but they didn't actually change the conditions on the ground for people because we took out the three clauses that would have done that because we didn't think they were important because we were, not connected to that community, right? And so I think it's important that whatever it is, whatever you're passionate about, that constant communication and bringing not just like one or two, oh, we had some drug user back, look at this and the first draft, but like multiple people looking at it from multiple different directions. Because really, if you've met one drug user, you've met one goddamn drug user, right? We are not a homogenized group. right? So you need to constantly look at how these are going to affect people, and specifically people who are most marginalized.
Thank you so much, Charlie. So with 11 minutes on the clock, I am going to stack the questions. After we hear from Deborah Small, I'm going to give special dispensation here because there's no way that Deborah Small can come to the mic without us acknowledging that we would not even be having this conversation if it were not for her work. For me and for some of the other folks to do this work undergirded by one another and to do it having had a mirror to look into. When I first learned of the work that Deborah Small was doing a long time ago when I was in Essence magazine, she had no mirror. She had to make this up out of whole cloth herself. And the fact that any of us are sitting here today having this discussion is because this woman stood there alone 15 years ago. Please recognize Deborah Small.
Thank you all. I'm going to speak fast because we got a line here, a queue. I just wanted to raise a couple of questions that speak to the way in which Art started this panel and to what Cassandra said at the beginning. Because she started the day by acknowledging the work that everyone has done and is doing that has brought us to this place where we are today. And you started this panel by talking about the principle of wanting to get rid of eliminating criminal penalties for users and possessors. And I listened to that and I thought about that and I was like, you know, that is what we've accomplished over the last 20 years, is to really shift that conversation. But inside of doing that, we've left out the majority of the people who look like us, because we've always known, even when we came up with that language, that the majority of the people who go to prison for drugs go with the label as traffickers, not as users, not as possessors. So I'm asking, why is it in 2016 that we're still holding on to that principle and still saying that we're for racial justice? Because those two things are not compatible, number one. Number two, the conversation about what is a trafficker needs to actually match what it is. Yeah. And it's not anybody who's ever sat at that table or sat in this room. It's big pharma, it's big advertisers, it's big banks. We never talk about the fact that every major bank has pled guilty to drug trafficking money. Every single one. That the market for opiate abuse was created by big pharma and promoted by big advertisers. But we never talk about them as having complicity or accountability in the area of trafficking. I am done with this shit, people. I'm in my don't give a fuck years, meaning I'm saying. It's like what the world believes is a reflection of what we've been saying. If you look at Wings, if you look at Breaking Bad, if you look at those shows, they are a reflection of what we've been telling them. Be good to the users and the possessors and fuck over the traffickers. If we don't want to continue to see our people taken away because we're giving them away, we need to change that language. Thank you.
I feel included.
Let me go ahead and pass the mic to the lucky person who
followed. So I work with brilliant, beautiful, resilient young men who are frustrated. And I'm just committed that we end the cycle and that we make them live free. And I see that what we're not doing is keeping it real. Thank you. Perfect. And we're not keeping it real about drugs. We're ultimately stealing them and keeping people lost in their lives as good and bad, as we will their little brothers. And we have them for a period of time, though. And I guess my question is, how can we be more effective with that time around keeping it real? Because politicians, it's difficult, it's hard with the Department of Corrections as well to have conversations that actually make a difference.
Your mind for Gladys.
You know what?
Yeah, I actually do, because like at a certain point, I'm sitting in a cage and I have dreams about what do I want my community to look like. So when people are pushing out these theories around broken windows, when I know that every day that one of my homies is going to get out with skills and trade that could actually repair a community, nobody thought enough of us to actually frame us as if we were an asset instead of a liability, if we had anything to contribute to the community, to the general conversation. The way that we shape and handle our money, it's almost like we will be preferred to give the money to a treatment program than to give the money to the person whose couch I slept on. So at a certain point, you could have attached economics to my release. You could have attached the opportunity for me to actually repair the broken windows. You could have actually allowed me to buy the abandoned houses. We could have restored our own fucking community. But we are not letting us engage in a conversation where we have aspirations and dreams and ownership of this stuff too. So when I says, let's not screw Pookie again, it's a broader fucking concept.
Thank you, Dorothy. Yeah, two more questions.
So my name is Kamani, I'm a cannabis user. I'm also co-founding Cannabis Culture Association. I'm going to diversify and incubate the space. If people of color are interested in getting a legal cannabis space, please reach out to us. This question for Shiloh, how do we get more Caucasian male to own up and say white male privilege exists and get within the room to talk about culture together as one, as people?
I'm going to stack the last two questions, so thank you. Yes, hi, I just want to say thank you. I've enjoyed this panel. As someone who's married to a formerly incarcerated person, as someone who has been fighting for freedom since 1619, this is a protracted struggle, so I thank DPA for this and all the people that are involved in various levels that they are for the time that they have on this earth. My question is to Jazz. You said that you sold drugs to consenting adults. I am now an adult woman, but as a child, my father suffered from alcoholism and drug use. And what that meant to my mother, his wife, and his children, and the children that I worked with in high school, I don't know how drugs, even if it's sold to a consenting adult, does not affect children, because it destroys families and it destroys communities. So I have I'm curious and I'm concerned how that could be, that it doesn't affect children.
That's a hot button question. Thank you. So, and we're gonna answer everything. I just wanna get the last question here and then we'll address all three.
Hi, my name is Tal, and I'm a GS alum. I'm also a former business owner, and we used to work with a halfway house. We used to employ formerly incarcerated individuals. So I'm very new to this world. I don't even know what harm reduction is, but just to tell the story in a short manner to ask that question. So my knowledge of this subject is through seeing my employees going through the troubles of trying to deal with addiction and basically what I'm trying to say is for us as business owners who did care for our employees and wanted to help them stay on the job, it was much more helpful for us to lose employees, because what happens there is that we're constantly given information about how to fire employees. So very important, how can be there more information for employers who want to work with people, who want to help them stay on the job and succeed in that.
Thank you so much. So the first piece of Jazz, do you want to respond? What was the first question? The Charlotte? Shiloh, for you, talking about getting other white men to acknowledge privilege, the question about selling drugs and not possibly harming children, even if they're selling to consenting adults? And finally, how do we inform people in the workforce?
Okay.
So Shiloh had the mic first.
You can, I mean, I'm not trying to. See, we'd be taking mics even on questions now.
Shit. Why privilege?
I know, I'm telling you. So, speaking about how to communicate to white folks, I can tell you that it is incredibly frustrating and difficult, even in my own community of homeless people and drug users. I do a barbecue once a year for former homeless people and active homeless people in my neighborhood, and it's almost all white men who are formerly, and it's predominantly mixed race who are active, and all the white men talk about how, you know, they pull themselves up from their bootstraps and they did it themselves, and why can't other people do it? And I always have to remind them, I have to do this slowly and painfully, where I remind them to this person and that person and this person. They died and, you know, you got away. This person, you got arrested. And you actually skirted because of this person getting arrested. And each and every time you've climbed over someone of color and over someone who didn't have more privilege than you to get to where you are, so you did not do it alone. And the harsh, brutal reality is that white people don't listen to anyone but white people. And you have to be that, it's that peer model where you have to be like, I'm sorry, I'm gonna call you on your bullshit and we're gonna have this uncomfortable conversation and you're not gonna call me for months. And then you're gonna respond to me on Facebook about what an asshole I am. And then eventually you're gonna come to me a year later and say, wipe 10% of them and say, thank you for enlightening me. I didn't know because another white person told me this too. And I'm just being real.
Thank you, Shiloh.
I'm about to bring you to fuck with my white people.
You know, we speak about white people like they are a monolithic group. You know, every ethnic group that came to this country, the Irish, the Italians, the Jews, all of them went through the same thing that black people went through. To a lesson. To
yeah, no.
To,
no. To,
wait, hold it. I said, if you let me finish, I'm saying to a lesser degree.
Okay.
Yeah. But
okay.
Jack, yeah. Specifically to Dave Queen's question, though, I think we're asking
okay.
Out of time.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Just
to, yeah. Dave Queen's question, and hello, my sister. Yeah. In every apartment, in a home in this country, they have a medicine cabinet. And in that medicine cabinet, they have opioids and opioid derivatives.
I
don't. Yeah. Yeah. And anyone in America can go to a doctor and get a prescription for OxyContin or any of the other opioid derivatives, right? So I mean, if we're going to blame the drug dealers in the street that are out there simply because they have no access to the opportunity structure in this country, if we're going to blame them, then we must also blame Big Pharma and the whole medical profession. I mean, from my primary care physician, to the emergency room, to every hospital and doctor's office in this country. You know, I'm saying that, you know, drugs is about as common in this country as water.
That's right.
Yeah. You know, so, I mean, trying to blame one group for the ills or the repercussions of selling drugs, it's not fair.
Then I think that's just right. Yeah. Jazz, and Deborah was going to add something to that.
I'm going to add something to that.
So, sister, on a certain level, you are correct. You know, I think that we have a conversation in our community that underlies prohibition that drugs are bad. And at least if they're illegal, they're bad. And that people who use them or sell them are bad people. And as long as we operate from that place and believe that, then we're going to continue reinforcing this conversation. And so what I just really want us to be able to think about inside of talking about drug policy is what is our attachment to punishment? Like, what is it about us as a community that has us be attached to punishment in this way? Because the conversation that you started goes to, once you, the ultimate outcome of that is that person has to be punished because they're causing harm, because they're doing bad things. So I want us to actually think about how much we've internalized that, and does it actually support us? And if it doesn't, what's in our conversation that would? Because to me, human beings are meaning-making machines. We've made all of this stuff up to mean a certain thing. And to the degree it doesn't work, it's time for us to make a new story, a new meaning about our relationship to drugs.
Thank you. Thank you, Deborah. All right, we're going to take over from there. Can you take the last question on talking to employers about who can support their any partners they have using drugs?
I wanted to talk about the parent pain.
Oh, go ahead, do that, Doris.
Let's judge parents by how they parent, not by what they put in their pockets, not by what they put in their bodies. You know, there's racial discrimination or disparity in the child prevention, the child welfare world. Black people lose their kids because something is said by somebody else who has more respect than the black parent does. So we have to be careful with this drug endangered child stuff, because that can go downhill real quickly. I could have a neighbor who said, I don't like that he smokes that weed in his back porch. I smell it. You know, next thing I know, Child Protective Services is in my house, trying to take my kids from me. So racial discrimination exists in that world too. So let's be real careful to judge parents by the way they parent, not by what's in their pocket.